Yoshiko.
Oh, Yoshiko's here. She told me it was like 4 a.m. in Japan, so I'm
Oh
so
my gosh,
impressed.
you are so brave.
You are a trooper.
Hey Kathy, hey John.
This is so great.
Hi Ben.
Hi, Dr. Hay. Hi, Sonia. Hi, Jana. Scrolling through.
Megan Marshall's in the house.
Ooh. Hi, Edda. Good to see you here. It's been a while.
Andrew. Thanks for dialing in.
Oh, Jessica, under the AKA
Don't know how that happened, but I'm trying to fix it. It's not easy to do when you're in the meeting.
Yeah, I know how that is.
I'm trying to figure it out. Do you know how to do it while you're in the meeting?
To
Change the thing.
change your name in the meeting, I'm not on the fly. I'm relatively new Zoom user myself.
Okay. I'm going to try to figure it out. I'll be right back.
Okay.
There are a few dots up in the upper right of your own image. And I think you can click on that and it gives you options.
As I was saying, if you want to click on the upper right and find those little dots in your own face box, you can have some choices about renaming, I believe.
Oh yeah, it does. Well, cool. That's nifty. There's all these little quirks. This is maybe my, I don't know, third time like being in Zoom. You learn something new every time.
Was that Megan saying that?
I think it was. Yeah, she doesn't have her video on, but.
Yeah. Yes, I'm not sure. I wasn't sure we would be on camera, so I'm not sure I'm fit to be seen, but I'm here.
You are always fit to be seen, Megan.
Yeah. This might be a good time to just remind everyone, let everyone know, we are going to record this session for transcription purposes, and also my plan for it eventually is to archive it on the Margaret Fuller Society page. So I'm hoping that they would like to have it there. So just FYI, if you're okay with being on camera, there are going to be some interactive activities. So having your camera on and participating is great, and we encourage that and hope that, you know, many of you that feel comfortable doing that will do that.
No pressure though, completely optional.
Oh yeah,
many ways to participate.
If you want to, if you want to.
Lots of variations.
So Janessa, we have a pretty full house now. If you wanted
All
to
right.
It's 12:05 to be respectful of time. Maybe you could go ahead.
Yep, I will get started right now. Okay, I just have a few opening remarks and I want to introduce Christina, of course. So I would like to begin by thanking the UNLV Jean Nidetch Care Center, the Nevada Humanities Project Grant, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and the WESTAF Regional Arts Resilience Fund, which is a relief grant that was developed with the Andrew Mellon Foundation to support art organizations in the 13-state Western region during the COVID pandemic. Their generous support has helped make the Beauteous Tree, Margaret Fuller's Femality exhibit possible, and the wonderful talk we're having today as well. And of course, I want to thank the Marjorie Barrick and their wonderful staff as well. I am so grateful that these organizations exist and for the people within them that work so hard to make events like this happen. Could we have a round of applause? Thank you. Thank you so much. About 3 months ago, I met Christina over an email through the Margaret Fuller Society, many of whom are present today. Let's hear it for the Margaret Fuller Society. Yes, yay. Many thanks go to the Margaret Fuller Society as well. A shout out to Sonia DiLoretto, Charlene Avalon, and Jana Arsinger for their support for this project. Christina's enthusiasm for this project, for this exhibition concept, matched my own, and it was clear right away that this was going to be in a really exciting collaboration. I'm grateful for her help and patience as the Barrick and I navigated the process of setting up a Zoom lecture through Eventbrite. Her good cheer and creative zest have been a boon to me over these past months. Dr. Katabotis is a longtime member and newly appointed 2021 board member of the Margaret Fuller Society. She is the executive director at Transformative Learning at the Humanities at the City University of New York. She is a scholar of environmental studies, sound studies, and American literature. She has written articles for ESQ, a journal of 19th century American literature and culture, ISLE, Interdisciplinary Studies in Literature and the Environment, and the publication journal known as Profession. She is co-author with Kathy N. Davidson of the forthcoming book, Transforming Every Classroom, A Practical Guide. Her project, Sound Ecologies, Listening to America's Literary Vibrations from Emerson to Standing Rock, argues that embodiment and relationality are key to understanding the American literary soundscape, and it examines both human and non-human sonic occupations of territory. Her work has been supported by the Ralph Waldo Emerson Society and the National Science Foundation, and numerous grants from the Graduate Center of CUNY. I am so excited to listen to the incredible ideas and activities she brings to this exhibit today through this talk. Without further ado, please welcome Dr. Christina Katabotis. Thank you.
Aww, thank you so much for that amazing introduction. Oh my goodness. Thank you everyone so much for coming. I'm Christina Katabotis. My pronouns are she, her. For those who may not be able to see me right now, I'm a white woman with long brown hair, some gray if I'm being honest, and hazel eyes with a very blurry, fuzzy background behind me. The image on this slide is of two warbling flycatcher birds on a magnolia tree with large rubbery green leaves and big white flowers. It's by the American ornithologist John James Audubon. Okay, so before I begin, I should say that you ought to grab a pencil or another drawing utensil and some scratch paper, preferably recycled and repurposed. There's a drawing activity ahead, but again, it could take many forms. So participation we'll talk through in many ways. You can search for those supplies while listening, as I thank a lot of wonderful people, all of the people that Janessa mentioned. The talk will run for about 45 minutes with some brief but engaging activities. As a sound studies person, I follow the work of Jonathan Stern. And some of the methods in this talk are inspired by him. Others come from the book I'm writing with Kathy Davidson, who is here today. Thank you for being here, Kathy. It's a book on active transformative learning techniques anticipated in 2022 from Harvard University Press. And as Janessa mentioned, I'm part of the Transformative Learning in the Humanities with Kathy and with Dr. Shelley Eversley, who's also here today. So thank you everyone for being here. Thank you to Janessa, who invited me here today, Alicia Curlin, Paige Bachman, the Jean Nidetch Care Center, Nevada Humanities, University of Nevada, Las Vegas, and the Marjorie Barrick Art Museum for hosting me and for this truly inspired community-based exhibit that does the crucial work of connecting the university to its neighboring communities. I'm grateful also, as always, to the Margaret Fuller Society. So those here today are dialing in from all over, and I'd like to center ourselves briefly with a land and water acknowledgement. Magnolia, as you may know, are native to the southern US, but not to the places that Margaret Fuller inhabited. She spent most of her life in Massachusetts and in New York. I live in Brooklyn, New York, where I'm dialing in today from between the Hudson River and the Atlantic Ocean, where fresh and salt water mix like the present and the past. The first magnolia to be transplanted in Brooklyn was a Magnolia grandiflora, an evergreen tree that can grow to more than 70 feet in height, planted on Lafayette Avenue in 1885, about 35 years after Margaret Fuller's death. We know about Brooklyn's historic magnolia tree because of a 1950s movement started by Hattie Carthen, affectionately known as the Tree Lady, who wanted to save the Magnolia grandiflora. That resulted in this tree and neighboring houses' designation as a landmark and in the construction of a protective wing wall of masonry to the north. This particular tree, planted after the Jacksonian era of Indian removal, is a symbol of colonization as much as it is a historic beauty. And it's a reminder of climate change given the warming temperatures that allow it to thrive today. From Brooklyn, I'm just a subway ride away from where Fuller once lived, with the newspaper editor Horace Greeley and his wife Mary in Manhattan's Turtle Bay. Both places are home to the Lenape peoples, and Brooklyn is also home to the Canarsie people. The Canarsie and Lenape are the original guardians of this territory. They called this land Suwanhaki and Wampanoag long before metal glass buildings scraped the sky, when the island of Manhattan was mostly populated by the Lenape. Imagine the natural landscape as green and luscious, covered in forest and fields with a few lines of white smoke from small fires drifting up into the air, and the water surrounding the island a deep dark blue. As we meet today, let's reflect on the unfinished work of restitution, justice, and reparation. We uplift, honor, and speak the truth of these peoples. Anushik, thank you. What to expect? My talk today is made up of three parts. In the first part, I'm going to tell you a little bit about Margaret Fuller. She led a rich and intellectually rigorous life, and we could spend hours talking about her. But what I want to focus on are a few particular details that will situate her in the social and scientific context of the early 19th century. In the second part of the talk, I'm going to ask you to sketch something, and I promise there's a good reason for it. I'm guessing this is an audience amenable to making art. After we've shared our creations, we'll dive deeper into the magnolia of Lake Pontchartrain, and I'll get more into the history of the magnolia tree. The third and last part of the talk is about self-portraits, focusing especially on Fuller's own conception of self, and the short vignettes she wrote about the plants she observed in the spring of 1845. These are as much depictions of plants as they are symbols of herself in letters. I've chosen a selection of passages where she uses plants to say what she can't say in words. We will together, for those who are willing to participate, act out our own plant portraits in quick performances based on what we read. Part one, Margaret Fuller in outline. Fuller had a unique and original perspective on society. In her journal around 1839, she wrote, quote, "Woman is the flower, man the bee. She sighs out melodious fragrance and invites the winged laborer. He drains her cup and carries off the honey. She dies on the stalk. He returns to the hive well fed," unquote. As you can imagine, Fuller identified this discord and imbalance between the sexes in society, and she demanded nothing short of equal opportunity for women. She believed that if women were given their fair chance in society, a harmony of the spheres never heard before by human ears would ensue. She was an author, a translator, a music critic, a transcendentalist, a social organizer, and much more. Growing up in Cambridge, Massachusetts, she played the piano, studied Greek, metaphysics, philosophy, and read French and Italian literature. With a rigorous education, a rite almost exclusively reserved for young boys at the time, she would become an exceptionally accomplished intellectual. In her lifetime, she translated works into German Romanticism into English, edited The Dial, published pioneering work on women's rights, and was a foreign war correspondent for Greeley's New York Tribune. Her remarkable education, so unique for a 19th century woman, gave her a kind of out-of-the-box view of femality, because intellectualism was considered a masculine attribute. In her daguerreotype, if it weren't for the long dark hair swept into a braided bun and the ruffles at the neck of her dress, she might look like a man, elbow propped on a table, quietly reading a book with his hand on his temple. Fuller sometimes described herself as feeling more like a brother to her male friends. Nevertheless, this was the century of Victorian sensibilities, the meek and mild angel of the house, the social oppression of women that confined them to the domestic sphere. Many of you familiar with Fuller know that her disconnected experience of living in society as a woman, but being perceived as having the mind of a man, is likely what led to her insight that gender, although this was not a term in use then, sometimes feels embodied and equally disembodied. In other words, Fuller understood that femininity and masculinity are not tethered to the body, but socially constructed. Moreover, she understood these gender identities as passing through one another, never fixed or stable, and never fully materialized or finished. She famously asserted that there is, quote, no essential difference, unquote, between men and women. She wanted to unfurl those categories, and she believed that giving women equal opportunity to be what they would be, let them be sea captains, she exclaimed, would restore to society what it was so desperately lacking, the equal contributions of all its citizens. The flowering tree in her story, the Magnolia of Lake Pontchartrain, is a towering sovereign, the queen of the South, whose powerful fragrance permeates her domain. In many ways, the Magnolia is a perfect parallel figure to Fuller. It was an ancient foremother in the complex coevolution of plants and insects that gave way to a multitude of highly evolved species today. Fuller came into prominence just as nascent ideas in evolutionary science were bubbling to the surface. And it is no coincidence that her radical conception of gender mimics the fluidity of nature. Her notion of femality is organic, co-evolving with society, transcending any one individual, and resisting any fixed taxonomization. Fuller was a voracious reader and translator of the German poet Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, and his theory of colors had a profound influence on her view of nature. Goethe's theory of colors was a treatise on the nature and psychology of color, including color's impact on mood. His book is filled with color wheels, diagrams of light refraction, spectrums, contrasting colors, and more. A modern example of the prism spectrum is Storm Thorgerson's cover art for Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon album. Goethe, who, like Pink Floyd, had a deep appreciation for theater, was primarily interested in human color perception, whereas Isaac Newton was more concerned with analytics and the visible spectrum. Seeing color was, to Goethe, a phenomenon mostly dependent on an observer's perspective. When perceiving beings engage in nature, colors emerge in our embodied visual processing. Also, no color is stationary or isolated. The colors we see change depending on what is juxtaposed. You'll hear me talk about a similar phenomenology of gender. One's gender identity, I argue, often can depend on who we are standing next to. Fuller also was embedded in the time of Alexander von Humboldt, who emphasized relationality in nature, what he called the chain of connection. He and Goethe both had more dynamic views of nature than the Swedish botanist Carl Linnaeus, the earlier plant taxonomist whose scientific protocol lives on today in the classification system of plants. Linnaeus, of course, played a role in naming the Magnolia of Fuller's story. The Magnolia genus is named after the French botanist Pierre Magnol. The name first appeared in 1703 in the French botanist Charles Plumier's genera. To make a long story short, and it is very long, Linnaeus, who was familiar with Plumier's work, but in all likelihood had never set eyes on a magnolia tree himself, adopted the name. When Linnaeus gave us a system of classification to identify species, one that would help us learn to observe species evolution, this system wasn't without embedded racism and other faults, big and small. For example, where do you put a platypus or a tomato? As to the latter, perhaps it really depends on taste. What about cilantro? We could imagine one early scientist classifying cilantro as an herb and another harvesting cilantro to make some soap. So it really depends on taste. Taxonomy is a useful heuristic, a foundation for a story about nature that we can rely on to grasp different species and evolutionary adaptations, but with an abundance of caution, where it comes from, its history, its problems. A more holistic understanding also recognizes that observations are never objective and serve the observer, not the observed. Rather than thinking in taxonomic terms, Fuller's conception of nature was more fluid and also more focused on the web of relations, the interconnectedness of life on Earth, which was one of Humboldt's ideas that caught fire around the world, slowly revolutionizing older notions of nature. Moreover, she cared less about the details of classification and focused instead on the union of poetic and scientific sensibilities like Goethe. What I am arguing for today is that we might look at this more dynamic view of nature, per Fuller and Goethe, as a model for a more dynamic understanding of gender, where much depends on who one is or isn't standing next to. It's not just about who we are, but also where, when, how, and why we are that forms our identity. So we're moving into the next part. And this is where I'm going to stop sharing my screen and ask you to draw, if you like, or make, create your own magnolia. Find an art making utensil, any utensil. It could be pen, pencil, marker, paintbrush, scissors, and a piece of paper, or it could be scrap fabric, a piece of mail, a shopping receipt, a plastic or paper bag, a post-it note, and draw a magnolia from memory. It could be the flower, the leaves, the whole tree. And there are no rules. You can cheat, look up pictures online, whatever you like, but just take a moment to craft some kind of magnolia, or if you'd rather, you could just describe something that you see or are thinking about in the chat. That works too. Or you could cut a piece of paper to make a three-dimensional magnolia. The beauty and the point of this activity is that it's low stakes, and no magnolia is going to look the same. We're not aiming for accuracy here, just like your relationship to what you see and what you're thinking about. And I'm just going to play a little bit of music while everyone does this. Thank you. Okay, thank you everyone. I hope you got a chance to take your eyes off the screen. If you are willing to unmute your video and show us your Magnolia, I would love to take a screenshot. So, but I'll give you forewarning before I do. If you want to show us, I had a little time. The flight of the bumblebee forced me to be really fast. So low stakes. Alice, you want to show us yours? Wow. Oh, I love it. That's awesome. And Alicia shared about her parents in the Southeast. Chicken. That's too funny. Oh, wow. Look at that. Oh, I love that. That's so sweet. Magnolias and chickens. Oh, Molly, that's great. Oh, wow. Look at you, Jessica. Wow. Oh my gosh, Magnolia Avenue in Cambridge, who knew? Hi, Sonia. Did you do one too? Oh wow, and you added color, that's gorgeous. Wow, I'm really sad about my Magnolia compared to yours. Wow, you are outshining us. Oh my gosh, Jana, that's lovely. Oh wow, that looks like you could be on Hawaii right now.
There's actually a magnolia tree right outside my window.
Hey, that's perfect. Oh my gosh. Rebecca, that's beautiful. So if everyone would be willing to just hold up their magnolia, I'd love to take a screenshot if that's okay with everyone. I'll count to three to give you a little forewarning. Oh, wow. Look at all of these. Oh, thank you for drawing with me. All right. I'll give it a little more time where people are unmuting. Oh, wow, so cool. You did it on your phone. All right, ready? One, two, three. All right, thank you, everyone. That was awesome. Oh, that's amazing, E. All right, thank you, everyone. And feel free to like keep, you know, responding in the chat as we go. This was really, really fun. Thank you. Okay, I'm gonna share my screen again. Here we are. Okay. So I told you there was a reason, in addition to the transformative learning techniques we do at TLH, this activity really calls attention to the role of the observer, what it is you are drawn to most, what's in your backyard, what street you grew up on. We can learn a lot from Fuller's practice of observation. Like Goethe, she was fascinated most by individual perception, feeling, mood, emotion, attention to and communion with nature, identification with nature, facilitates explorations of self through kinship, reflection that leads to self-understanding. We can find freedom to be ourselves in nature, freedom from social organizers like language, categories, and so on. There is no having to put oneself into this or that box, but simply life in motion, attraction and repulsion, gravitation, affinity, kinship. Does it matter if the rock in the middle of your favorite stream is made of dollar stone or shale when you know it as your favorite stepping rock to hold you steady and get you safely to the other side still dry every time you cross? Just as one rock is composed of a multitude of minerals and sediments that change over time, our identities are multifaceted and fluctuate. Fuller was most interested in these kinds of impressions, and when taken together, we might arrive at some common definition of a magnolia, or femality, or gender, or feminism, But we can't brush over or forget the fact that our differences, our diverse range of lived experiences that we bring to the table. So the Magnolia of Lake Pontchartrain was inspired by a visit from Dr. William Eustace, who Megan Marshall, hi Megan, describes as, quote, I love this description, a lonely bachelor in his 50s and an avid amateur horticulturalist, unquote. He stopped in to see Fuller's mother, Margaret Crane, before she traveled south and relayed his own account of the Southern Magnolia. Fuller remarked that he spoke of nature not like a botanist, but a lover. Her narrator in this story is likewise full of awe at the tree and from the outset, but for her story really takes a proto-feminist turn, becoming, as John Madison frames it, a personal manifesto of Fuller's. And I'd love to get a volunteer to read this excerpt out loud. And I'll need several more volunteer readers throughout the talk. There are quite a few quotations. So please put your name in the chat, which will serve as our list. And Janessa has kindly volunteered to keep track of who is up next as we encounter more of these passages. Janessa, do we have a volunteer? Oh, you're muted, sorry.
Egan is our first volunteer.
Thank you.
Hi, can you all hear me?
Yes.
Great. I found her at last, the Queen of the South, singing to herself in her lonely bower. Such should a sovereign be, most regal when alone, for then there is no disturbance to prevent the full consciousness of power. After I had recovered from my first surprise, I became acquainted with the flower and found all of its life in harmony. Its fragrance, less enchanting than that of the rose, excited a pleasure more full of life, and which could no longer be enjoyed without satiety.
Thank you so much. Fuller's Magnolia here is mystic and powerful. The tree shares her story with her audience. Originally, we find out, she was an orange tree who offered her fruit to merchants and her flowers to brides. This state is symbolic of a conventional 19th century woman's, white middle-class woman's fate. Megan Marshall reminds us that in addition to being a public intellectual, Fuller became a primary caretaker in her family following her father's death. She was a school teacher, a convener of her famous Boston Conversation series, and more. Reflecting on her time as an orange tree, the Magnolia says, I had no mine or thine. I belonged to all. I could never rest. I was never at one, which might as well have been spoken directly from Fuller's lips and by the lips of many more women in the 19th century and earlier. In this story, cold weather and exhaustion lead to the orange tree's death, at which point she meets the queen and guardian of flowers, who counsels her to take a step inward and become a magnolia. And this queen of the South, now standing before this narrator, is no ordinary 19th century anthropomorphism of a woman-gendered flower. The tree is far from delicate or fragile. In fact, this depiction matches closely to the magnolia in Francis Sargent Osgood's The Poetry of Flowers and the Flowers of Poetry. Could I get the next volunteer?
Next volunteer is Ben Bascom.
Ben, thank you.
The Poetry of Flowers and the Flowers of Poetry by Francis Sargent Osgood, Peerless and Proud Magnolia. Of the splendid family of trees, the American continent has many species. They are distinguished by their rich, smooth foliage, large, fragrant flowers, and aromatic bark. Some of them are of very exalted stature, taking rank with the highest tenants of the wood. In the southern states.
You broke up.
Holding the air for miles around with their rich and delicious fragrance.
Okay. Thank you so much. So I'm going to come back to both of these passages again, but I wanted you to get a sense of the language Fuller and Osgood used using to describe this species. Fuller's primary attention is given not to labeling or measurement, but the process of observation. Fuller moves toward a harmonization of poetic and scientific relationships to nature, and we see this in several places throughout her writings. The first example on this slide is from Summer on the Lakes, where she also comments on the perpetual sound and creation of Niagara Falls as a symbol of the ongoing, indefatigable motion of nature, which resists fixity. Could I please have two volunteers?
We've got Nat is next, and then Etta.
Great, thank you.
I'm here.
We need more after that. That's the last one.
The first one.
All right. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Every fact is impure, but every fact contains in it the juices of life. Every fact is a clod from which may grow an amaranth or a palm.
Beautiful, thank you. And the next one?
Sure, I can almost quote this one from memory, but I don't trust myself. Male and female represent the two sides of the great radical dualism. But in fact, they are perpetually passing into one another. Fluid hardens to solid, solid rushes to fluid. There is no wholly masculine man, no purely feminine woman.
Thank you both so much. So in the first quotation, facts are merely a starting point from which living beings and ideas may bloom. The second quotation is in both The Great Lawsuit and Woman in the 19th Century, where Fuller addresses the arbitrariness of gender categories to urge for equal rights for women, and here defines femality as a transitory state. Here she draws from scientific observations of natural processes to arrive at a more fluid conception of identity. She reconsiders gender as a mix and a perpetual movement of the elements, and in the words of the brilliant Janessa Kenway, casts a faint transgendered net across all of humanity. I'd love to talk more about the binary implied in radical dualism in the Q&A, but for now, it's important to know that for Fuller, there is no stable fact, only the fact of feeling, as Joan Richardson would say. Feelings, too, are crucial to adaptation. One must feel out an environment to respond to one's advantage. I'm going to turn for a moment to the impure facts and clods about magnolias, because their evolutionary history is quite fascinating, and it will help us come back to Fuller's story with two things. The first is an appreciation for the stories taxonomy allows us to tell, and second, a renewed sense of urgency to break away from overclassification in order to embrace a more dynamic understanding of nature, and with that, a more dynamic understanding of gender and of ourselves. Magnolias, we now know from fossil records, actually played a crucial part in the complex coevolution of plants and insects. They are an ancient, primitive plant species and one of the oldest flowering trees on our planet, older than bees, butterflies, and moths. Fossil records show that magnolias populated Asia, Europe, and North America over 100 million years ago, when beetles and flies were the most common pollinators. They are unique in their adaptation to attract beetles and flies with their sweet fragrance and dramatic petals. In Fuller's story, the tree has, quote, something peculiar in the fragrance, unquote. In their evolution, magnolias invested more energy in these structural and olfactory traits, and as a result, they generate far less pollen per bloom compared to other trees native to the US, like oak and maple, which depend on wind pollination, which is why they plague our senses in the spring and at all times. Millions of years ago, flightless beetles would amble and wander from bloom to bloom compared to the skilled bee or butterfly. Able to manipulate flowers to harvest their pollen, these early flightless beetles have been called dumb pollinators. However, they played a crucial part in the coevolution of insects and flowering plants. In 1841, Fuller would not have known this history, but we can easily identify the adaptations of the magnolia in the tree she describes in her story. Magnolias evolved their large, showy flowers and fragrance to attract more flightless beetles and adapted to their chewing mouthparts made for gnawing, not harvesting pollen, by growing tougher, thicker leaves. Still today, 8 species of magnolia in the US have been observed to move their petals, stigma, and stamens to deny other insects access to their flowers. Recently, botanists have measured a decline in pollen flow that may compromise the magnolia population, and some have noted that due to warming temperatures, magnolias now bloom earlier in the spring season and well before most pollinating insects, such as beetles, emerge, usually in the early summer, and this interferes with magnolias setting seed. The world we are creating with monocultures and human-driven climate change doesn't bode well for magnolias, even though we can see them thriving in unlikely places like a tiny front yard in Brooklyn. Our survival, as much as that of plants and insects, depends on biodiversity. And I want to return again to the fact that feminism, femality, gender, and so on should not be monocultures either, but diverse and vibrant. We might look even deeper into Earth's history at the first plants to live outside of water and their inhabitants to find examples of extremely dynamic, vibrant beings and how they managed to survive and thrive in a hostile environment. As Robin Wall Kimmerer points out in her book, Gathering Moss, many entomologists believe that the early stages of insect evolution took place in the mats of mosses. Some species of mosses have evolved a means to increase their chances of finding a mate, becoming bisexual or transsexual, altering their gender freely. And some, like the tetraphis, are sequential hermaphrodites, moving from a cloning phase to sexual frenzy, and changing gender from female to male as the colony begins to crowd itself. Kimmerer writes that in a changeable habitat, quote, natural selection favors flexibility rather than commitment to a single reproductive choice, unquote. This is one of the many lessons to be learned from moss, and I highly, highly recommend her book. As I dug deeper into the long life of genus Magnolia, which is composed of varying numbers of species depending on the dates of reclassification in taxonomic history, I was most surprised to find that the Magnolia's closest genetic relation is the buttercup. I'm no botanist or taxonomist, but it's safe to say that things got really wild with the introduction of DNA assessment. For instance, as my colleague Andrew Dunn pointed out a few weeks ago, we share a large portion, more than half of our DNA, with bananas. So to draw again from Robin Kimmerer, both a biologist and a writer of indigenous heritage, quote, the scientific way of knowing relies only on empirical information from the world, gathered by body and interpreted by mind, unquote. She uses indigenous ways of knowing, understanding through all four aspects of our being, mind, body, emotion, and spirit, to supplement scientific ways of knowing. We could take her example when it comes to gender categories. We can supplement them and use them as ingredients in the soil to grow around, over, under, into, and through them. Fuller's perception of nature and gender, Fuller's Magnolia, is something else entirely different from Linnaeus's way of doing things. Dismantling traditional gender roles and sciences that fit people, animals, fungi, and so on into categories that organic life perpetually resists. A good reason why science as a field also continually re-examines itself and evolves. Fuller engages all the senses to tell the story. She describes the magnolia first by smell. There was, she writes, a fragrance beyond anything I had ever known. It was of a full and penetrating sweetness, too keen and delicate to be cloying. Then by sound, the poet of the lake which could utter such a voice. And then when the queen is found at last, she describes the magnolia as perfection in sound and stature, singing to herself in her lonely bower, such should a sovereign be, most regal when alone, for then there is no disturbance to prevent the full consciousness of power. This depiction recalls again Osgood's magnolia, which is peerless and proud. I want to be sure before moving on to the third and final part of the talk that we address the tree's transformation from orange to magnolia tree. Fuller is evoking dynamic nature and gender fluidity, but she's not talking about a 19th century understanding of trans identity. And I want to recognize and unpack that a little bit while also leaving room for us to read it that way if we want to, not anachronistically, but as a means to reflection. Fuller is most definitely portraying metamorphosis and using that natural process as a metaphor for the 19th century woman's withering and transformation into a more empowered and independent identity, what would later be known as the new woman, a late 19th century concept of womanhood that comes closest to Fuller's Magnolia. Fuller would have been aware of the metamorphosis of caterpillars into butterflies and tadpoles into frogs, as was Goethe. And Goethe extended this to the metamorphosis of the leaf into stem, leaves, sepals, petals, pistils, stamens, et cetera. While Goethe valued the order that Linnaeus's system classification brought to voluminous nature, he wanted a scientific approach that could account for variance, for internal and external transformation, and for what he called morphology. The fact of the matter is that no matter what terms we use, transition, transformation, or metamorphosis, bisexual or pansexual, they are inadequate to describe lived experience, the unified movement of spirit and matter. Fuller loved the bodily vibrations and emotional impressions of listening to music, and she called music the best language because it activates the body, touching on something beyond words. She knew that representation is a poor substitute for real embodied experience. And in the 19th century, ideas about communications between bodies were more relaxed. Lisa Blackman in Immaterial Bodies reminds us that communication in the 19th century, quote, was seen to defy fixed boundaries between the self and the other, material and immaterial, unquote. Goethe took a note from Spinoza's book that, and if I could please have the next volunteer.
Next volunteer is Andrew Wildermuth.
Spirit and matter, soul and body, thought and extension are the necessary twin ingredients of the universe and will forever be.
Thanks so much, Andrew. When we take Fuller and Goethe's innovations into account, we might look at taxonomy as one way of telling a story, and a problematic one, a hermeneutics crucial to our understanding of evolution, and yet also a perfect point of departure, especially when it comes to thinking about gender identity and sexuality. When we unfurl taxonomies of plants and of genders, attempts to categorize and classify become mere moments, snapshots even, of a fluid, ever-evolving process of living and of growing. So, Fuller's blossoming botanic imagery constructs identity from natural resources, from leaves and branches. And here is where we get into flower symbolism, Fuller's depictions of herself as a flower or plant, and her idea of the self. By the end, we'll all be moving around and getting into poses of our impressions of Fuller's spring flowers. One of Fuller's innovations as an early feminist was her ability to cast women and herself as flowers, charming and disarming her readers with tropes they would recognize, while employing all surrounding natural phenomena to support the fact that these personified plants are powerful photosynthesizing organisms, not Nathaniel Hawthorne's delicate and fragile blossoms. As Jeffrey Steele argued, Fuller persistently chose a feminine center of power over a masculinized one in her poems. Steele called special attention to her lunar poems. For example, both in her poem titled In a Fair Garden, and the poem she offers as an epigraph to Yucca filamentosa, Fuller positions the central flower as being nourished by the moon, typically associated with femininity, and the ancient Greek and Roman goddesses, Selene, Luna, Artemis, and Diana. In this same vein, Fuller drew from floral metaphors, a kind of matrilineal inheritance. She spent time in her mother's garden as a young child and remembers it full of choice flowers and fruit trees, which her mother carefully kept. The garden was a site of self-expression for her mother. As Corinne Reiner has argued, Fuller wrote to William Henry Channing in 1844 that she inherited from her mother a connection with the flowers, and that her mother's love for flowers rooted in her and grew into a deeper understanding and interpretation. Fuller reflected, and if I could have the next volunteer.
Jana Arsinger.
My writings about them are no fancies, but whispers from themselves.
Thank you, Jana. So again, while drawing from familiar tropes, Fuller chooses nature's petaled heroes as her inspiration. As Steele noted, Fuller's early feminism really unfolds from the self-discovery of her matrilineal heritage and its applicability in her intellectual pursuits and writings. I'm trying to pass on the same kinds of values to my kiddo, as you see him here sticking his face into a yellow tulip, which is his way of giving it a kiss. Fuller's chosen European influences fostered her sensibility and willpower early in her life. A young 21-year-old Fuller sought the freedom of nature, which was her custom, according to her journals, when she could no longer bear the weight of her feelings. Sitting by a dark and silent pool of water, she recalled asking herself as a young child, and if I could have a volunteer for the first.
John Hay.
How is it that I seem to be this Margaret Fuller? What does it mean? What shall I do about it?
Thank you, John. And, you know, this also just shows us, actually, you know what, let's just get to the next volunteer. Is there another volunteer?
We're out.
We're out. Okay, I can read it. Or Janessa, would you read it?
Wait, we've got, what, someone just popped in. We've got Ashwaraya. Oh, I'm sorry, that's a difficult
name. There is no self. That selfishness was all folly. That I had only to live in the idea of the all and all that was mine.
Thank you so much. So discerning this by the pool, her determination while facing a dark and silent reaction are really Fuller's own assertions of self. She cannot find her image or hear an answer to her questions outside herself, so she must design the meaning of Margaret Fuller and make her future truly hers. The embrace of the all in which she finds herself is exemplary of the capaciousness of personality. She undeniably becomes Fuller by choice. I join Fuller's latest biographer, Megan Marshall, in reading Fuller's shedding of selfishness by the pool as not an erasure of self, but a claim to, as Marshall phrases it, quote, give up the self so that all could be mine, unquote. There may be no self, but there was her self-reliance, her will to do something about Margaret Fuller, to exert her influence and thereby help advance the all. This balance of individualism with a sense of duty to the collective favors action over Calvinistic waiting for divine intervention and provides the foundation for her pursuits in the latter half of her life. So to close, I want to bring us back to the wonderful, generative, creative force of community and harmonized action of all who contributed to this art exhibit. To do that and to wind our way toward Q&A, I'd like us to read and act out, pose our bodies in performance of and in response to some vignettes of plants in Fuller's letters. I learned this method from social presencing theater community at City University of New York. Social presencing theater, as Heather Huggins and Aviva Geismar describe it, reclaims the body as an equitable way of knowing and being. So we'll all do our own mini self-portraits in reaction to Fuller's plant vignettes before I move to Q&A. If you're willing to unmute your video, that would be great so we can see everyone. To set the stage, the plants in these letters were coming into full bloom in the spring of 1845. Fuller was living with the Greeleys at their home in Turtle Bay, then at the upper edge of New York City, and she was engrossed by her interest in James Nathan, to whom she addressed these letters. Do we have any volunteers?
Yes, Phyllis has volunteered.
Phyllis, would you mind reading for us? And people who want to unmute can do their various impressions.
I have in my bosom a large bunch of English violets, which I wish might shed their perfume over this letter. We have whole banks of them here, but I have to gather them for myself. If you were here, you would bring them to me.
I'm loving, there's like hugging their arms. Oh, that's beautiful, radiant. Thank you. Let's go to the next one. Okay, so this is after some bad news from James Nathan. Things weren't going to work out with Fuller. Would someone volunteer to read this one?
I'll volunteer.
Thank you, Janessa.
Yet in that garden must be amaranth flowers, not born to die. As to what I said of a brother, I felt distaste to the use of the word. I have seen too much of these brothers. I think it is fairer to have a nameless relation which cannot be violated and may grow to what it will.
I love that reaction, Andrew. Okay, bye. That's so good. An amaranth. Look at these amaranths. Beautiful. Let's go. Let's do two more. Could I have a volunteer for this one?
Do you have any more volunteers? Sonia?
Today the lilacs are all in blossom and the air is full of a perfume which causes ecstasy. I feel chosen among women. I have deep mystic feelings in myself and intimations from elsewhere. I could not, if I would, put into words the spirit facts. Indeed, they are but swelling germs as yet. And all I do for them is to try to do nothing that might blight them.
I see lots of swelling, big, taking up a lot of space. Wonderful. Let's do one last one. And we could break it up. If someone wants to read the first paragraph, I'm happy to read the last one.
Okay. Do we have any more volunteers? Jana says she'll read again.
Thank you.
The tulips are out now, and the crimson ones seem to me like you. They fill gloriously with the sunlight, and the petals glow like gems, while the black stamens in the cup of the flower look so rich and mystical. I have gathered two and put them in my vase, but the perfume is almost overpowering. There are also two golden ones that have rooted themselves on the edge of a grassy bank. I do not know how they could get there. It was a strange elopement from the regular flower bed, but the effect is beautiful. A flower so were name or noble eminent, willing to be wild.
I have been sitting in the twilight in the spot where we have been several times. Always something unpleasant occurred when we were there. But it has all endeared us to one another and ennobled the relation. And now a shrub has starred itself all over with white flowers and bends over the place. Well, yeah, I love these. Thank you, everyone. That's it. I'm happy to talk through Q&A and thank you for all of the volunteers. I really appreciate you breaking up the monotony of my voice.
So yes, if we have questions from the audience, this is a great time. You can type your questions, or if you want to speak, you can also do that. If you type it, I would be happy to read it for you, or Christina can read it. I am just, of course, just over so excited about this talk that my brain is just buzzing with all of these ideas. It's amazing.
Well, thank you very much. And thank you. Thank you, Megan. That's so nice.
Yes, thanks for being here.
It's so wonderful to be in a room of scholars I so admire. So thank you all. It was very nice to hear your voices. Okay. We can just go like two tulips. In the wind.
Hi. I can't be on camera today. I'm on the go.
No worries.
But you said you wanted to talk more about binaries in the Q&A. Mm-hmm. And I think the capaciousness of the gender system you were talking about was really interesting. And this really ties into what you were saying about classification with an abundance of caution. When you're talking about evolution, I was wondering if you could get more into the thoughts you couldn't fit into that part of the paper.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, Fuller really believed in this great radical dualism. And this really comes from a sense of polarity, also a theory from Goethe, but one that Emerson really adopts. And polarity being this kind of, you know, Emerson talks about it in Compensation, like this tit for tat or plus and minus, but it's not, I think what's important to kind of remind ourselves is that like that binary for Fuller and for Emerson, and I think for Goethe too, it's about the energy, the attraction and repulsion, or that gravitation or affinity in between, that movement. Not it's being born on a stair. It's not that there are these two stable ends. It's that there are these ends that we will never be able to reach. Kind of like Ahab in Moby Dick, will never get the whale, you know, will never feel whole or complete. And I often think of Ahab as this metaphor for trying to achieve a particular kind of wholeness that we just can't get to either of those ends. And so it's always some kind of radiation or like electric energy in between, or magnetism. But yeah, thank you for the question. And I think also it's just really important to remember this history and how it's used for evil and not for good. Particularly Linnaeus. And I think it's really important to remember that Fuller's idea of a conventional 19th century woman is really, and the new woman that comes after her, is really based on a white middle-class model. And Fuller, you know, she visited Sing Sing. I know Ian, I, and many on this this talk are on the Diversity and Inclusion Committee and the Fuller Society. And I think it's just also important to like recognize the problems also and the limitations of Fuller. You know, she certainly tried, but she certainly white ladied it, you know?
All right, we have a question here from Phyllis in the chat. She says, thanks Christina and Janessa. What is there about or in relation to flowers in WNC beyond the radical dualism passage?
Janessa, do you want to speak to that based on this beautiful exhibit? I haven't been able to visit in person because I'm in Brooklyn, but I'd love to hear you
Images. For me, it's just the radical dualism passage really just started to kind of make sense when I started visualizing it in the different works of art in the exhibit. For example, one of the works in the exhibit is a painting, a watercolor of sort of this crater, and it looks like kind of like a leaf in water. And then it's a diptych, and its companion piece is a pink water lily blooming. And so for me, this just spoke to the kind of energy flowing between these two things that would seem to be maybe unrelated, but that there's a flux and a blooming and a sinking that's kind of this, that just embodies this kind of energy that we're talking about. And neither one of the forms is superior. They just represent the energy going back and forth. I'm not sure if that answers your question about the radical dualism entirely.
Phyllis?
I just am struck by how this gorgeous array of letter passages comes right after the publication of Woman in the 19th Century, which was February of 1845. So spring is flowering all around her in New York City. And I want to put together what a kind of spiritual biography of her growth beyond that. In what she's observing.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting too, because there's this other passage that we didn't read where she says, my little rose tree casts its shadow on the paper. They bade me cut it down to make it blossom. And so have I done, though with a reluctant hand. So is it on earth, but not so will it always be. The soul protests against it and sometimes, somewhere, claims its own in full. And I think this passage is such a moment of personal triumph. And, you know, following women in the 19th century, I feel like it must have been very difficult for her to have invested so much emotion into a man, to be rejected and to have to pick herself back up again. And I think that butchering of the rose bush and being forced to regrow and grow bigger is like the perfect metaphor of, I think, of what that must have been like for such a painful experience for her.
Mm-hmm. Great. I know that Jana said she wanted to raise her hand. So I'll raise it for her if she has a question that she'd like to ask.
Thanks, Janessa. I have a couple of comments and a couple of just practical questions. First of all, Christina, what an enchanting presentation. I'm so taken by, one of many things, by your idea that our identities are profoundly relational, and that that's part of their fluidity. That really speaks to me. And I love, not unrelatedly, the way you created in the presentation this multivocal experience for us all, and multivisual. It was just wonderful. Thank you. And Janessa, I wish we could all just be transported right now to where you are, so we could see the exhibit. Is the museum, one of my practical questions is the museum mounting any digital archive, anything that we could actually visit remotely?
Yes, there will be a virtual digital catalog that's going to be available at the close of the exhibit. But I am actually looking to get us some pictures sooner than that, so that people can kind of see the exhibit. I should have had that in place sooner. It's difficult to keep everything happening so quickly, but I will definitely be putting together, if nothing else, a blog with some images for the Margaret Fuller Society page, so that you guys can get a taste of what this exhibit looks like. Then, you know, with that in mind, kind of reflect back on this talk and consider those things together. But absolutely, there's going to be a really beautiful digital catalog that will also be kind of a permanent archived item that everyone will be able to access.
Fabulous. That would be wonderful. And I'm wondering if can you copy there were some lovely comments in the chat, and just thinking about the deposit to the Fuller archive. Okay, that would be great. And also, could that include, Christina, the pictures that you took?
Yeah, sure. Okay.
Yeah, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah, I should get those for the catalog too, so we can also put a page about that.
Yeah, and thank you, Alicia, for posting the link to the photos in the chat. And I just want to respond to Ben. I think in terms of other ways that Fuller's sense of descriptions have informed an approach to her work, I think giving myself permission to have feelings in my scholarship has been Fuller's influence, that we're allowed to feel when we read these and to talk about those feelings, and that those feelings are incredibly valuable, right? Like reactions of, you know, feeling violated or angry or upset about plenty of things that came out of the 19th century and before, and also feeling a deep sense of love and admiration and inspiration and vibration from the things that we read.
Excellent. I think we had some questions in the chat, so I want to get to those before we run out of time. Molly asks, Christina, yeah, really taken by the photo and your discussion of the Magnolia in Brooklyn. You're making me think about lots of travelers to the Lowcountry are totally smitten with the moss and Magnolia when they travel south. I love how this is another way we can trace how she talks about place, transcending place, etc. I can't remember specific passages on flowers in the dispatches. You're making me want to reread them. Yeah. I don't really see a question in here.
But I think it's important, because I think, you know, when I went back to prepare and read the scholarship on flowers and Fuller, I find it quite outdated. And that's why I wanted to not shut down any kind of reading of these flower passages, because I think this is an opening for all of us who want to engage with them, reflect on them, and take them to task in a totally new moment for us. And I think that, well, a new moment that's not so new.
Yeah, actually, I'm really excited to look at more of this. I feel like, you know, I'm entry level with this Fuller Scholarship. So your presentation has given me all new directions that I definitely need to look deeper into myself. So thank you for giving me some clues to follow. We have one last comment here in the chat from Ben. He says,
I'm sorry. That was the Fuller sense of descriptions, how it's informed your approach to work on Fuller. But Ben, I don't know if you wanted to add anything.
Okay, good. Make sure we cut it. Okay. I wasn't sure that was which one we had got to. Any other questions?
You're welcome.
Yeah, just thank you for all the positivity. This has been such an exciting journey to make this happen and see everyone come together like this. It's great being part of the Fuller family.
And thank you, Janessa, for organizing, and Alicia and Paige and everyone for putting this together.
What's this? Magnolia fragrance.
Interesting.
Let's check that out.
Can I add something to this? It was a wonderful, wonderful presentation, and it made me think of all sorts of different connections, but I was actually reminded of a sentence in Margaret Fuller's last article that she wrote from Rome, and when she was actually in Florence, actually. But she wrote about Rome, and she said, "We pushed away the flowers to see the cannon." Mm. And that, you know, I mean, it made me think of my experience of seeing the magnolia when I came to the US, you know, to study, and the fact that traveling and transnational experiences are also very much marked by these experiences of flowers and how we see at those flowers and what is the priority that we give, you know, in certain moments. And it seemed to me interesting that at one point, you know, the canon was more, you know, the flowers were, you know, somehow covering or neglecting the full, you know, how the full vision of what she was experiencing in Rome, you know, could be described as canon class flowers.
Well, and you will love this, Sonia, and I have to thank my friend Austin Bailey for giving me this book, but Goethe's Metamorphosis of Plants was inspired by his trip to Italy. Yeah. And his whole idea of metamorphosis came from seeing the plants and his travels in Italy. So there's so many connections too between Goethe and Fuller and travel.
Thanks so much. It was such a wonderful, wonderful lecture and experience. I loved all the things that you asked us to do. So thank you so much.
Excellent. All right. Well, I think we're just about out of time. And I just want to, you know, thanks everyone for being here. And it's been great. And for all the positive thoughts. Much love.
Yeah, thank you so much. Take care, everyone.
Take care. Have a good rest of your week. And Christina, before you take off, you know, you mentioned you would send me the paper that you wrote for this.
I would love to. Now.
look through that again. There was so much there that I know I need to read it again.
And there are footnotes too for the things that I realized that I had put most of my notes in the speaker's notes, and that because it was in presentation mode, no one could see all of the citations. And so there are citations too. And what I'll do is I'll send you the slides as well, because there are links to where the images are from and all of that.